Welcome to Lost Tracks. It's an interview program where we're talking about the stories of musicians, their gear, performing, and the music business. Many of those stories come from the Portland music scene, and Lost Tracks are the stories that don't necessarily make the front page. But the people we talk with are really, you know them as your local musicians and friends and business people. And they have very interesting stories, and we're going to share those stories with you. My very first guest is Dave Rosenberg. Dave is the bass player in Beathead, but that's only the tip of the iceberg in his music story. He started off in Buffalo, went to Berklee College of Music in Boston, moved on to Nashville, and eventually came to Portland, where he established himself as the go-to bass and guitar player, one of the tops in the city. And he's not only a member of Beathead, he has all of the musical genres covered. Reckless Company is his country and rock band. He flexes his jam chops with the Brothers Jam. He's in an Elvis Costello tribute band called the This Year's Model. And he's played with countless others. We're going to hear more about Dave's history and then talk about his approach and philosophy and kind of get an idea of what his gear is. You know, he's got some very cool things that we want to learn a little bit more about. So anyway, Dave, welcome. You're the first guest on Lost Tracks, and
thanks, Steve. I'm honored. That's awesome.
I hope I got some of that intro correct, and
if you were pretty close. Yeah, you got it all.
I figured you set me straight. But I guess first off, I have to ask, as a working musician, how have you weathered the pandemic? How are you getting your musical fix?
I'm not. Well, I'm playing a lot at home and doing stuff like that. And I have been doing some outdoor gigs and some acoustic gigs. And so Reckless Company had a lot of stuff going over the summer with the Brothers Jam. We did some really good live streams. And we did, I think, one or two actual live gigs. And then we did a country club down in Salem. So we're doing stuff. Mm-hmm. It's just been kind of a lot of time in between, shall we say.
Yeah.
I should be practicing.
I know, me too. we're supposed to do some recording here shortly. I better get my chops up for that.
I know. I gotta work those things up.
as Beathead starts to rebrand and redirect itself towards being a yacht rock type of band, and as you always said, we're one Pablo Cruz song away from being a yacht rock band. So
we totally are.
So anyway, let me back up a little bit. Let's start off with those early days. You were born and raised in Buffalo.
Yes.
You played a local music scene there. What kind of music?
Well, early in the Buffalo days, after I finally did learn how to play, we were just doing a lot of cover tunes, like just classic rock stuff of the day. But, you know, we were trying to do things like Rush and, you know, some challenging stuff. I don't know how successful we were. One of my earliest bands, we didn't have a bass player. It was just two guitars and drums, and wasn't much on vocals for us either. So that was kind of challenging to play that stuff. But, once I was really playing a lot, I actually ended up moving away to going to Boston to go to school at Berklee. And that's where I really got into a whole lot of different things once I got there. And of course, original music, I was in a band called The Clicks, which with my buddies there in Boston at school, we had a really cool little power pop band. Hmm. Or as they say there, power pop. It was wicked awesome.
Well, Berklee, it's the top music school in the country. And so what was it like being there with the creme de la creme?
You know, it was just music all the time. And you were seeing all these people walking around, and you knew who like all the great ones were and who were playing with the cool ensembles and, you know, people who were getting hooked up with artists early on. So they were all kind of walking among us and living in the dorms with us. And now I see these people's names on records and, you know, recording engineers who are doing huge sessions are good old friends of mine. And, you know, it's just really, it was a cool time and it was really fun. And it kind of was all a blur if I look back on it now, but I did a lot of playing and I went to school a lot and I worked a couple jobs and, you know, just tried to stay in it.
Was it intimidating, you know, with all those great musicians and competitive?
I've never been a terribly competitive person, so I wasn't really intimidated by them. I felt fine just kind of being in my own zone, and the people around me were of similar style, and there were some great players around me, but everybody was really very nice and cool, and, you know, I had good relationships with a lot of people that I still am in touch with today. So what
did you learn about yourself as a musician?
I learned I could do almost anything, and that was the main thing. I've started to feel really comfortable in, you know, walk-on situations and being able to take it with bands and fill in with bands and pretend I knew what the heck I was doing, and it all seemed to work out pretty well. And when I moved from Boston to Nashville, I started doing a lot more of that, a lot more of that fill-in work, which led to a lot of things for me.
So still thinking about Berkeley here, you know, so what kind of influence did it have on the trajectory of your music career?
Looking back, maybe I didn't even take as much advantage of it as I could, but it gave me confidence. Definitely gave me confidence. I was able to speak the language of music with people that I played with, and I knew what they were talking about when they would ask me to do certain things. And I just felt comfortable walking into situations and playing. I did some recording when I was there, and that was my introduction to the recording world. And I found I was pretty comfortable doing that as well. So,
well, I mean,
it must have
prepared you to go to Nashville. What exactly were you doing? What did you do in Nashville?
Well, I originally went there because a guy I used to play with in Boston, he and his brother got a record contract on MCA. And I was talking to him one day after this all happened and their record came out and I had a copy of the cassette. And I said, you know, he says, I'm looking to put together a band, a tour. You interested? And so I said, yeah, why the heck not? So I learned all the tunes on the cassette. And, you know, I learned them kind of note for note on guitar. And I went down there to audition for these guys. And I did my audition and it was great. And, you know, but then I saw the guys coming in after me were doing all that Nashville string bender telly stuff. And I didn't know what the heck that was. I was totally unprepared for that. So long story short, they didn't hire me for guitar, but he did say they needed a bass player. So,
and that was the birth of you of mastering the four strings.
Yeah. Well, you know, he said, do you have a bass? And I said, yeah, which I didn't, but I was going to be in Nashville for another 4 or 5 days. So I decided I'd find the closest music store, a place called Corner Music, and they had all kinds of amazing high-end instruments all over the place. And I picked up a bass and went back. I shedded the cassette again on bass.
Oh, wow.
And I went back to the Musicians Union to do my bass audition. And I wasn't comfortable because obviously I wasn't a bass player. I didn't know what the heck I was doing. So there was this guy over by the bulletin board, kind of a tall guy. He had this big old beat up leather gig bag, red baseball cap. He totally looked like he knew what he was doing. So I went over and started talking to him and I said, I'm doing a bass audition and I'm not really a bass player. You got any, like a 5-minute tutorial you can give me here? And so he did. He gave me like a couple of really good solid tips. And he said, gave me his phone number. He said, come find him after I do the audition. And you know, he might have some other things for me. And it turns out he was a guy from Buffalo.
Oh, no.
And we knew some of the same people. And he was also the bass player for Jerry Reed at that time. So
okay.
He was a pretty happening guy. And I'm still friends with him on Facebook today, too. So that's what really, I got the gig, long story short.
Wow.
And I started playing with this. I played with the band I went to audition for, but that didn't last long. And something happened with them and they stopped touring. I don't know what the whole story was there, but this other guy, this bass player, hooked me up with a bunch of other people, and I started going on the road with country bands playing bass. That was not in my original plan, but I really enjoyed it. It was super fun, and the music was great. And there you go, all these years later.
Was that a real traditional country approach, or was it kind of still softening up a little bit?
No, it was a lot more modern stuff,
really?
Or at least in the 80s,
uh-huh.
The modern stuff of the 80s, which I liked a lot, and I did learn some traditional country too. So,
okay. So
it was,
So you were in Nashville, how long, how many years were you doing that thing?
I was there probably about 5 years, maybe.
Okay.
Maybe six.
Okay. So, what ultimately brought you to Portland?
Well, when I left Nashville, I actually went back to Buffalo, and I did a lot of work in Buffalo at that time. I was there for probably about 11 years.
Oh, okay.
And I did tons of good recordings and played tons of gigs and, you know, was playing with people who had major label interest, and we were trying to do showcases and driving in New York a couple times a year to do showcases. And so there was a lot going on in that period between Nashville and Portland. Ultimately, Michelle, who you know, dragged me out to Portland. And that's a whole nother story in itself. But
we'll have, we have to have another podcast or something that goes into those kinds of things. Okay. So that brings you to Portland. So how long did it take for you to kind of break into the music scene here, and how did you go about making connections?
Well, I picked up a copy of the Willamette Week and started looking in the back of that, because I didn't have a computer at that time. And I started answering ads in there, looking for bass players, and got hooked up with a guy who I'm still good friends with here, Gabriel Trees, and he had a band going on at that time, like a little kind of R&B blues classic rock band, and eventually started playing with them. And then there was another band I was playing with, and just started doing local gigs. I wasn't really trying to make it big or do anything major. Obviously, I haven't made it big, so so I was successful in that.
It's big in our minds. Come on.
There you go. But yeah, just wanting to play all the time, and that was it.
Yeah.
You know, I had a day job, but the reason I have a day job is so I can play music at night. That's what I tell people when I do a job interview.
That's
like, I'll be out front with you. This is why I'm getting a job with you, so I can do this at night.
That's great. So you started, you know, you'd been around for a little bit. I don't know how long you were here when I met you. It's probably been about almost 5 years, I think. And I was blown away, you know, on your mastery of the bass, but then I found out you're a hell of a guitar player. and I know that you play guitar in Reckless. When somebody says, what do you play? You know, do you say, oh, I'm a bass player, I'm a guitar player? I mean, how do you describe yourself, and what's your favorite?
Well, I usually throw both out there, and it depends on what I'm doing more of at the time, which one comes first.
Mm-hmm.
So,
okay.
I started getting back into guitar maybe about five or six years ago. And I really hadn't been playing it that much prior to that. I really got the Jones to keep playing guitar, and I started buying more gear, and I wanted to get in bands, so I started playing with a different Grateful Dead band on guitar, which is no longer around. They were called Northbound Rain, a really good Dead band, and still friends with most of those people. And it just got my playing back in order, and I found out after all these years of playing only bass that my guitar playing had changed into a whole new thing. And suddenly I could sort of do some of those country licks that were eluding me back in the day. So when I was in Reckless Company and we went through some personnel changes, At one point, I offered to be one of the guitar players along with Mike Suffin and get a different bass player. So, and that's been working out pretty good, mostly.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Sometimes I still play bass with them, but I play a lot of guitar with them now.
So you have a, you know, I've witnessed a, you know, the best way I could describe it is a broad portfolio of bass guitars. I've seen you play six string basses as well as a Paul McCartney like Hofner. And some of those basses are pretty special. Can you walk us through some of your favorites and kind of give us a little bit of a kind of a rig rundown on some of the bass guitars?
Absolutely. I actually have my two current favorites out here. This one here, I've kind of gone back to playing a lot of four string these days. Uh-huh. And just, it's just, you know, another phase. I go through phases all the time. This is kind of a 90s, it's actually a Tom Anderson bass. And if anybody is familiar with guitars and knows Tom Anderson custom guitars, knows that he doesn't make basses, but he used to make bodies and necks for some of the other high-end bass companies, Sadowski being one. Mm-hmm. I know he made it for Moon Guitars in Japan. And I think Kenzo Sir, he was originally back in the 90s making these necks and bodies for them. So it's super high-end bass. It's really light. It's got this nice, beautiful pinkish finish where you can see some of the wood grain in there. Mm-hmm. I have no clue what the electronics are because this is kind of a bootleg. I think somebody got a hold of these necks and bodies or one shipment and started making these nameless bootleg jazz and P style basses. And my friend over at Old Town Music knows that I like basses, and I especially like basses from Japan for some reason. I don't know why. They're always really good. So this one was a Japanese import, even though the body and neck is stamped Tom Anderson, and so it was made in the USA.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously, he knows me well, because the second I played it, I bought it. That was that.
Well, it sounds...
So that's that one. And the other one that I have out here today is a 1988 Yamaha BB3000. And this is a model that I have been chasing since the 80s. I almost bought one in the 80s, probably around the same time when I was just starting playing bass. There was an earlier model of this was out there, and I didn't buy it because I thought, well, I'll save a few $100 and this import Fender will be fine. And it was okay, but I've always regretted not buying this bass back then. So this is currently one of my...
Does Yamaha
one of my favorites?
Does Yamaha have a reputation in basses? I mean, I know that they're all, you know, they do a lot of things. I mean, I had an acoustic for years, and it was a nice one. You know what? You don't see a lot of Yamaha basses. I mean, I don't think I don't see them too much.
They make amazing basses, and for years, some of their models are really fantastic. But I will say for Yamaha, any Yamaha instrument I've ever played, even the lowest price ones out there, are always great.
Mm-hmm.
I have a fairly inexpensive acoustic from them that I use a lot, and just a great guitar, and it's a workhorse. And you know, if something happened to it, I wouldn't be heartbroken because I know I can just buy another Yamaha. They're always out there.
Yeah. So,
but they're higher end stuff, which this one is one of the higher end basses that they made. They're just amazing.
What kind of pickups do those have on there? Do you know? Are they just came stock?
No, they're like a proprietary pickup that they made. They always made their own pickups. And but they're set up. You can see it's kind of like a precision bass and a jazz bass pickup. So it sort of has that sound a little bit, that PJ thing, but it's got its own thing. It's actually a neck through a body. Really beautifully made, and it has a really kind of a warm, very thick, not a ton of punch, but like just a really nice velvety tone, which I love. Fits in with a lot of things.
So any other, did you drag out any other basses that you wanted to show or Those are number two right now.
Those are the two number ones. I'll show you this one too. Because you mentioned it.
Hell yes.
This doubles as an aircraft carrier when I'm not playing bass on it.
Is that the problem, the same kind of problem people have wearing Les Pauls all night? Is it pretty heavy?
It's super heavy, yeah.
Yeah.
It weighs a ton.
Yeah.
But it's a great bass. It's fun to play. Sounds amazing. It's made by a company called Low End, the Low End Bass Company in Nashville, which is a bass store, and he also makes his own brands, and essentially they're classic body shapes, like this is a jazz bass essentially, but he does them in multi-string setups.
What's it like playing a six-string bass?
It's like playing a four-string bass. Like the middle strings are the same as a four.
Okay.
So you have your low B, which I do play a lot of five strings, so I'm used to the low B. The high C allows you to stay in position when you're playing a lot. So you don't have to like jump up for some of those high notes, but also it's great when you're playing up high, you can do chords, you can do melodies. It really has kind of the lower guitar range to it. So it's super nice for a lot of other kinds of music where you're trying to add some melodic things to it.
That's very cool. Yeah. I think when we first started playing together, you were using that one quite a bit. And
I still pull it out a lot, but, you know, I go into these phases of basses and I play different things.
Well, that keeps you looking for new stuff all the time, right? And
that's half
fun.
I think one of the pictures I sent you has the sparkly Music Man in it, which is another one of my favorite basses. I
gold one, yeah.
Bought it in 2002 and it's still in my collection today. I bought it from a friend of mine in Rochester, New York when I was moving out here. And actually, it's an 02, but I bought it in 03. And
was that in your glam band, hair band phase?
No. But it worked really well in those days.
Yeah. So what is there, you know, and you also have, you know, you show up with interesting array of bass amps as well. Is there anything that... you know, that you're particularly interested in right now or you know, that you're pretty excited about?
Well, right now I've really been liking just like the standard Mark bass amps that you can find at Guitar Center. And they're really well made. They're super light. They're small. They're loud. The tone is great. I used to play in Eden a lot, which I loved. And the Mark bass head and cabinet kind of reminds me of a little bit of the Eden tone that I used to be able to get. I still have that Eden too, but I don't bust it out as much as I used to. Yeah, these little newfangled Class D power amps that have high power and low weight and small size are just amazing.
Well, it's really interesting how the pendulum is really kind of a swinging sort of, I mean, you know, especially in guitar amps. Where you're starting to see all these modelers and solid state kinds of things that essentially are recreating the sounds of classic amps pretty well.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of, you know, utility, and, you know, I know that a lot of the guys that tour a lot, you know, they'll just bring along one of those modelers what is it, like Axe FX and some of those.
Axe FX and Kemper.
Kemper, yeah.
And Line 6 has some really nice things in that type of line.
It's interesting. I follow this guy who was the founder of 65 Amps, and he's sort of phasing himself out of that business a little bit and doing sounds for like your computer, you know, but you're going to have the equivalent of that amp on, you know. And I was listening to somebody yesterday who was talking about, well, maybe I'll just bring my Mac out on stage and play through those, you know, those little modeled effects. It's crazy, you know, versus, you know, all of the reverence that you know, with the boutique amps and, you know, the Marshalls and all that kind of stuff with the tubes and such. So interesting to see where it goes. to a whole new generation of players.
Yeah, I'm afraid of that stuff. It's too much tweaking for me. I like good old fashioned amps and pedals because it's easy. I show up, I plug the amp in, I plug the pedals into the amp, guitar into the pedals, and there you go. It's good to go.
You use a couple of pedals on the bass occasionally, I see.
Mostly I just use a compressor and a preamp.
Okay.
Because some of my basses are passive, so I use the preamp to kind of juice them up a little bit and get a few more tonal options out of it. I like compression on bass because I think it just kind of evens everything up and gives you a good punch to it. Mm-hmm. I have a little envelope filter if I want to do some of that funky type stuff. But, you know, when I'm playing with the dead band, I can't use that much because they're using it a lot. That's the Jerry Garcia sound. And I don't want to step on that. So I throw it in once in a while.
Yeah, I read.
Really, the only other pedal on bass is a tuner. So.
I read that, you know, you have to be wary of a bass player that shows up with a massive pedal board. So that's good that you're, you know, you're pretty.
I'd be wary of them too.
So what about the guitars and those guitar amps? You've got a very interesting Strat, but I know you've got some other cool stuff too. What's shining as number one these days?
Probably the Telecaster. Here's the very interesting Strat with P90 pickups and the standard pickup in the middle. And this is made by a guy, it's a Frankenstrat made by this dude up in Port Townsend, Washington. And so it doesn't say Fender on the headstock, it says Freeman. The guy's name is Rod Freeman. And it's just a pretty amazing guitar.
He used the same F, I see.
Hey, now, don't say anything.
doesn't D'Angelico, didn't they come out with that dead player? I can't remember the guy, but it's got the P90. It's got a three pickup configuration as well. Have you seen that?
I think I have seen that. Just walking through, I know Guitar Center carries those, and so I've seen them there. This is not an ad for Guitar Center, by the way. No, I'm not anti-Guitar Center. I love all the local music shops in Portland. I love Trade Up and what do you call it? Old Town Music especially is one of my favorite stores. And then up here in Washington, we got a place called Beacock Music, which is a great place. And I have a Strat that I picked up from there recently, and it's like a real Strat with real Strat pickups. And because I didn't have anything like that. And I think there's a picture of it in one of the photos I sent you. But this thing is really cool. This is a Japanese Telecaster, Fender, Fender Japan. And I've kind of Frankensteined it over the years. I put some really interesting pickups in there that are custom made by a guy down at Grants Pass. And I don't have the box handy right now, so I can't remember what the heck they're called. But these are amazing, and if anybody is interested in finding out more about it, they can contact me. But what's really cool about this guitar is I put this little dealio on here. It's called a rolling bender. So it gives you that country B bender thing without actually having to route out the back of the guitar.
So how do you make that happen? What is it? You just use your hand?
Yeah. Oh. I don't know if you can hear that, but yeah. I could plug in. But so this guitar is great. It's super light. It really speaks. It does everything it does great country sounds. It's great for rock. It's great for anything you could think of. And it looks cool.
Yeah.
It's called an Antiqua finish, which some people really like, some people hate, but I kind of love it.
And there's no pick guard, apparently, that's...
There is a pick guard and it's in the same finish as the body.
Yeah,
it matches.
Hold me. Yeah. Very nice.
So that's a great one.
Yeah.
And but I get a lot of use out of that one. And then there's this one here, which I love.
Ah.
This is a 1977 Les Paul, and it's just a, you know, their basic natural maple finish. And the interesting thing about it is it's a factory second. I don't know if you can see the back of the headstock there, but it is stamped second. So back when Gibson used to sell the stuff that, you know, didn't quite pass muster for whatever reason, I think the only thing about this one is it has a knot in the wood right about there that's a little bit raised, so not too bad.
And a lot of relicing companies would feature that, you know?
They certainly would. So these are the three main guitars I'm playing these days. But also there's a Paul Reed Smith, which is one of their SE models that I'm playing, which is super nice. It's a semi-hollow body, kind of Les Paul style body. It has a really nice flame maple top. It's their Zach Myers signature model. Now, I don't know who Zach Myers is, but it's a nice guitar.
And you too could have.
So I'll take their word for it that he knows what he's doing.
That's good.
Then there's that Strat that I mentioned before, which I have yet to bust out in a live situation, but that's coming.
we'll make sure that we see that picture of that thing before that you unleash it on, you know, some audience somewhere. You've always been chasing a little bit of the Dumble sound for amps. Is that one of the destination amps for most of your guitars?
Yes, I do use the called a Serietone, and it's a Dumble clone. It's a pretty well known clone among the world of people who chase that tone. There's a lot of them actually, and that's one of the earlier ones, and they used to sell them as kits. And so my friend actually bought one that was complete, and he played it for a while and decided to move on into other things. So I bought that one from him, and I play it quite a bit. It really has a great Dumble type sound. I mean, people who love that sound will argue that each one of them was different and unique in their own way, and I'll agree with that. But they all have sort of a common denominator to the sound. I also have a few pedals that kind of capture that sound, amp in a box type pedals. And I switch between those two because each one of those pedals has a different version of the Dumble sound. So most of my basic sound is based on that. Although I like the Vox sound too, and I do use a Vox AC30. And I got another Vox, which is called the Vox Tony Bruno. And it's this guy from New York that Vox contacted to build them a really different kind of circuit than most of their amps are. And they, for a while, I think probably about 8 or 9 years ago, were distributing these amps. And I think one of the pictures I sent you, it's a black Vox amp with sort of white piping on it. And that's the Tony Bruno. And it's kind of a mixture of an AC15 and a Princeton. It's got both of the, it's like if you mix both of those amps together and it's 18 watts, it's really a great small venue amp, and it sounds amazing.
I was just listening recently some discussion about AC30s, and that depends on, like, in the last 20 years, apparently there was a period of time when Korg owned Vox. I don't know if they do now or not. And they also Marshall. And Marshall was making those AC30s, and so that was a good one. Most recently, they're being made in China, which is, you know, it's not
quite. And the AC15 I have is Chinese, and it's an amazing amp. I love it. Also, no matter where I go, I keep one of these in the car.
And what's that?
It's called a Quilter.
Oh.
And it's a 50-watt amp, and it really is quite an amazing amp. So if something goes down on stage, I always have this with me. You can see it weighs nothing. It's crazy loud. It has a sweet gig bag. You know, it checks all the boxes for me. I love that amp.
Well, Quilter, that's basically the QSC, right?
QSC, yeah.
That guy, I think that guy.
And so
I go way, way back. It's actually, so does Mike Suffin. We both had these amps called Duck amps back in the 70s.
Yeah, he told me about the Duck amps.
Yeah, and the guy who, I think that Quilter guy actually was the man behind Duck amps. Nobody's talking Pat about Quilter. Duck amps anymore.
I don't think you can't even find one anymore.
No.
If I saw one, I'd buy one just from Mike's description of it.
My band back then down in Berkeley, everybody in the band had one. It was pretty interesting. But anyway, so yeah, I've heard some, Quilters is kind of finding a little niche. And what about your pedal board and what things are happening between the.
Oh my God, my pedal board is nuts. Really? And it's always changing. I'm always swapping things in and out, but there's a lot of pedals on there, but essentially it's actually a pretty simple concept. I always have a compressor at the beginning of it of some sort. I'm either using the Mad Professor Forest Green compressor, which I love. I also have a JHS Orange Squeezer style compressor that I use a lot. What the heck's it called? The Plush Effects, which is made by Fuchs. They have one called the Royal, I think it's the Royal Plush. And I do use that sometimes too. It's really a nice basic compressor. And I like a real basic kind of a Ross style compressor for a guitar or an Orange Squeezer. So if you're a guitar player and you know compressors, you're gonna know what those are. They're just different types. And from there, I usually run into either like one of those little mini phase 95s or some kind of pedal like that kind of gives you a little bit of maybe a chorus pedal sometimes I'll use. From there, I have two different distortions. One's going to be like the Dumble style overdrive, which I'll have set fairly clean, but with a good loud boost to it. And then usually I'll have my OCD pedal or something like that, which I'll have for a lot more crunch and drive. And they're set about the same volume. And then after those, I put a RC boost pedal, which is a really nice clean boost pedal with some EQ on it. And so if I need more out of either of the other two pedals, I use that to pump those up. From there, I go into a volume pedal so I can have all my overdrive pre-volume so I can really still have a good overdrive sound with the pedal at lower volume. And then from there, I go into two different delays. One's a Catlin Bread Belle Epoque, which is like a Echoplex EP3, essentially. And I have that set mostly for like slapback, echo, and country type sound. And then I go into another Catlin Bread, what they call the Echo Rec, which is kind of their updated modeled version of the old Benson Echo Recs, which was the drum style echo that David Gilmour was famous for using with Pink Floyd. And I use that for my longer delays, or I'll use it for sort of those, that fast type of dotted eighth note delay that you hear, like the Edge in U2 does a lot. So I'll do a lot of that kind of stuff with that pedal. From there, I go into a pedal that it's the Strymon Flint, which does reverb. It gives you a few different types of reverb and a few different types of tremolo, because I love some tremolo. And then from there, I go to the Strymon Lex, which is a Leslie effect style pedal. And that thing is just amazing. So we don't really have to have a keyboard player in Reckless Company, because I'm doing a lot of these sounds in the background. And people always ask me, if the keyboards are canned or if we're playing to a recording, because they hear that, but it's not. It's just me doing crazy things.
Yeah, I've got a delay that has an amazing, it sounds like a B3 sometimes. It's amazing.
Oh, yeah. And in front of that pedal board lately, especially with Reckless, I've been using a few other pedals just to kind of increase my guitar collection. So one of them is a pedal that it's called the Mosaic by Digitech, and it makes it sound like a 12-string, and it's like a really good 12-string imitation because it does the octave strings on the low, and then on the higher strings, it's unison sound. So it really sounds like a 12-string guitar. If you close your eyes and look the other way and have three beers. It sounds exactly like a 12-string guitar.
That's amazing.
And then the other one I use is the Digitech Drop, and I use that for a lot of baritone guitar type things. And so I get a lot of action out of that stuff.
Wow. That must keep your guitar tech pretty busy. When is he doing everything off stage?
No, I'm doing it right on stage.
It's always
nobody knows how to set my crap up. I can tell you.
It's always interesting to when they're doing that and they talk to the techs and you know they're standing by. They're the ones that are actually pressing the buttons, you know, on all the songs when the other guy guitar player's not even close to the pedal board.
No, I'm tap dancing all night on that stage.
It's a different world that those guys are doing. So, yeah. So anyway, so did we leave anything out?
No, I think we covered a lot of stuff. I mean, really, I just wish there was more gigs going on right now. I know I'm going to do something acoustic with Katie from Reckless coming up here soon. And hopefully with the band too, we have some more ideas for things that we've been talking about. More Brothers Jam stuff coming up. Hopefully some Beadhead coming up soon.
Yeah, we got
to get that Yacht Rock happening.
We have a Beadhead thing in the offing here I need to talk to you about. But it's, I guess that's, you know, my last question was kind of like, what's on the musical agenda? And I guess it's just like whatever we can find, right? You know, it's.
Yeah. I mean, I know these guys that have a Huey Lewis band and they're friends of mine and I actually sit in with them sometimes for rehearsals when the regular guy can't make it. I think I did one gig with them. I hope to do some more this year. Mm. I'm the one in the posters though. So when you see the posters for Shades of Huey, that's my picture in there because the guy couldn't make it. So I sat in for him. And then there was I had been playing with the Pretenders band as well. And so hopefully it's called Precious and hopefully we're going to do more with that. And, but you know, it's just COVID has put us all on such a hold here that nothing is happening.
Yeah. Well, hopefully they will see some light at the end of the tunnel here. My guess is it's not going to open up until we can start going a little bit more open air. So it's, you know, I was approached by one place and they're literally putting the band behind Plexi. So be everybody be like in a drum aquarium.
That's it. I bring Plexi for my amps usually, for guitar amps anyways.
Yeah.
It makes singers happy. I don't get yelled at. It makes sound men happy at casinos when you bring the Plexi.
Yeah.
So.
Yes. It works well in the casinos, I know. Well, Dave, thanks for taking the time. I know you're as anxious as I am to get back playing again, and you know you've got all those toys and all those things that need mastering, and so I know that the rest of the world is anxious to hear you as well. So, thanks again for taking the time.
Oh, thanks, Steve. This is great.
All right.
Really fun.